Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Today we'll discuss the Palmer-Wilson syndrome. Syndrome where we have the glossitis, that is the inflammation of the tongue, and dysphagia, that is the difficulty in the swallowing, and callonychia, that is the clipping of the nails. These are the symptoms which are produced by the Palmer-Wilson syndrome. Palmer-Wilson, these were two persons who invented this syndrome, and this is due to the deficiency of the iron and certain multivitamins like the vitamin B12 and vitamin B6. So the definition of the Palmer-Wilson syndrome, where you have the dysphagia and the esophageal wave. Now, the esophageal wave, it is the wave or the formation of the fibrous tissues which replaces the epithelial tissues in the esophagus. Now, you know, in the pharynx, in the oral cavity, esophagus and GIT, it is lined by the epithelium. Now, this epithelium needs the iron for its replacement. There are millions of cells which are being shedded away from the oral cavity, pharynx, esophagus in daily life, and these are replaced by the presence of the iron. Now, if there is deficiency of the iron or the vitamin B12 or B6, then this epithelium is replaced by the fibrous tissues. Now, this replacement of the epithelium by the fibrous tissues is known as the wave. So, there is the wave formation in the esophagus, especially over the post-crequiate region, that is upper one-third of esophagus, or the junction between the pharynx and the esophagus, that is known as the crequiate region. So, post-crequiate region, where the normal epithelium is replaced by your fibrous tissues, and that is known as the wave formation. Now, this wave formation is causes the dysphagia. Patient feels the difficulty in the swallowing because of the narrowing of the inlet of the esophagus. Now, this Palmer-Wilson syndrome, the deficiency of the iron, where you have the no epithelium over the tongue, so tongue becomes a very smooth one, and it is that is known as the glossitis because the epithelium has been lost. Now, over the pharynx, again the epithelium becomes lost, or it becomes a smooth one. Now, if that condition prolonged, there is the wave formation over the post-crequiate region, and glossitis goes on with the passage of time, say about 1 year, 2 year, 3 years, then this turns into the carcinomas, squamous cell carcinoma. So, the Palmer-Wilson syndrome, you can say it is a syndrome which may lead toward the carcinoma, that is squamous cell carcinoma of the post-crequiate region. Now, this Palmer-Wilson syndrome is also known as the Peterson-Kelly syndrome. These were two scientists who invented this disease. Now, the risk factors in the Palmer-Wilson syndrome: race, you know, the whites are much more affected in ages between 40 to 70 years. Women are much more at higher risk due to the menstrual blood loss, as about 200 to 500 cc per month is being lost in menstruation. So, due to loss of menstruation, there is iron deficiency. Now, the pathophysiology, what happens? Iron deficiency, you know, iron is needed for the replacement of the epithelium, because millions of cells are being shedded away from the pharynx, oropharynx, and the whole GIT, which are replaced by another epithelium with the active participation of the iron. If there's iron deficiency, then this epithelium is replaced by the connective tissues or the fibrous tissues. So, epithelium is not replaced by your another epithelium. Now this iron deficiencies may include the gastrointestinal pyelorrhea because of hemorrhage in the GIT due to the certain reasons, celiac sprues there, nutritional deficiencies, especially the vitamin B6 and vitamin B12 which are needed for the replacement of the epithelium, because epithelium is a labile tissue which needs these vitamins to be regenerated. And then there are certain genetic predisposition where there is a tendency of the epithelium to turn into the fibrous tissue. Then the autoimmunity diseases like the rheumatoid arthritis, pernicious anemia, thyroiditis. Now what happens in autoimmunity, the antibodies are being formed which are destined to kill the target tissues. But sometimes these antibodies, they just causes the degeneration of the epithelia of the GIT and causes the replacement of this epithelium of the fibrous tissue. So autoimmunity has certain role which causes the arthritis, pernicious anemia and the thyroiditis. Now the what symptoms you will get in the Palmer-Wilson syndrome when the epithelium is replaced by the fibrous tissue. So there is a dysphagia, difficulty in the swallowing, that is typically intermittent and initially to the solids. The patient complains difficulty in the swallowing with the solid particles or solid food material. Then there are the odontophagia, painful swallowing because of the de-epithelialization, and the de-epithelialization exposed the nerve endings. So there are the painful swallowing because of the de-epithelialization and exposure of the nerve endings. Then third is choking spells, aspiration may occur because of the proximal location of the wave. Now, what happens when the person swallows having the Palmer-Wilson syndrome because of the wave formation? As you know, the wave means the condensation of the connective tissues or formation of the fibrous tissues or connective tissues over the post-required region in the initial phase of the esophagus. Now what happens, this swallowing material does not enter into the esophagus, in spite of that it goes toward the larynx and causing the choking spells because of the laryngeal spasm. Now then there are certain other symptoms like weakness, fatigue, dyspnea. Now weakness is the deficiency of the iron, vitamin B12, B6, fatigability is there, and dyspnea because iron also is needed for the formation of the hemoglobin. So when there's less amount of hemoglobin, does not carry the full oxygen from the lungs. So patient also have the dyspnea due to the iron deficiency in the form of the deficiency of the hemoglobin in the RBC, because the hemoglobin is needed in the RBC to carry the oxygen from the lungs. And weight loss, sometimes it's uncommon because patient can swallow the fluids, so he can overcome his weight loss. What are the signs? Now the manifestation of iron deficiency without or with anemia. And anemia means when there's a paler looking, if you see into the nails, these are paler looking. If you see into the eyes, it is paler looking. So this is anemia. Now what will be the manifestation or signs? Angular stomatitis. The angles of the oral cavity where you have the angles on both sides, there will be the ulceration over the angles of the oral cavity on both commissures, where the upper lip and the lower lip meet on the sides, it is known as the commissure. So this inflammation of the commissure is known as the angular stomatitis. So angular stomatitis, the inflammation of the commissure of the oral cavity where upper lip and lower lip combine together. Then the glossitis. Glossitis is the inflammation of the tongue. Now this glossitis or inflammation of tongue is due to de-epithelialization of the tongue where the epithelium has gone because of the iron deficiency, vitamin B12, or vitamin B6. Then the Kalonychia spoon nails. Now the Kalonychia spoon shape, you know, the iron is needed for the formation of the ground substance in the nails. Ground substance, the connective tissue, the proteins are there. So iron is needed for formation of these type of the tissues in the nails. So when there is a deficiency of the iron, then it becomes a spoon shape. Deficiency of the ground substance. Then the person becomes paler looking because of deficiency of the iron. If you look into the eyes, eyes will be paler. Does not look like having the much more flow of blood. Now other which are very rare but very very important, you have the splenomegaly. Now splenomegaly again due to because deficiency of iron, deficiency of the hemoglobin, the size of the RBC becomes larger. So they're entangled into the spleen and causes the splenomegaly. Then the edentia. Edentia means loss of teeth. Now this loss of teeth is again due to the deficiency of the certain vitamins and the iron. Now certain books, it's also written that to the esophageal reflex. Now the esophageal reflex means the reflex of the stomach contents into the esophagus, into the stomach and the pharynx. Now this regurgitation of the food particle or hydrogen chloride from the stomach to the esophagus or the pharynx, again it is due to the deepithelialization because epithelium is gone. Now the enlarged nodular thyroid gland. Thyroid gland, because you know the thyroid gland needs the certain proteins for the formation of T3 and T4. If there is deficiency of the iron, then their formation becomes hampered. Gastritis with echinohydria, again due to deficiency of the iron and the replacement of the epithelium with the fibrous tissues. Posterior wave, a wave formation or the connective tissue formation or fiber tissues over the posterior region. Or the posterior region is the region where your esophagus starts and pharynx ends. It is the junction between the esophagus and the pharynx just behind the cricoid cartilage of the larynx. That's its name is retained as the posterior region. This is the narrowest area of the esophagus, and this narrowest area of the esophagus affected with the iron deficiency and due to the epithelialization followed by the wave formation or the connective tissue formation. Now if you see the signs for the Palmer-Wilson syndrome, look for the palmar pillar. Now if you look on both hands, you will see one hand much more pink and another pillar region. And if you see the conjunctiva on the lower eyelid, you will see the pillar conjuncta. Otherwise, it would have been very red or pink if the iron would have been normal. So in these are both signs. The hands show the pillar, the conjunctiva shows the lower eyelid, where you will see the conjunctiva shows pillar. Now, chelitis. Chelitis, I mean, angular stomatitis, where you can see these are the angles of the oral cavity. This is the angle of the oral cavity or commissure of the oral cavity with upper lip and the lower lip, they combine with each other. This is the commissure of the oral cavity. This is another commissure of the oral cavity where upper lip and lower lip, they combine with each other. Commissure of the oral cavity. Commissure of the oral cavity. And when there's inflammation over this commissure, it is known as the angular stomatitis. Now, angular stomatitis, because this is the area where you have the greater movement of the oral cavity during the talking, during the speech, during the swallowing, or during the ingestion of the whatever the material you have. So there's a wear and tear over this angle. If there's deficiency of the iron, the epithelium, which tear does not replaced by another epithelium, but then it is replaced by the fibrous tissue. And then there is the inflammation over the ankles. So this is the inflammation over the ankles of the oral cavity and term is retained as the angular stomatitis. Angular stomatitis is inflammation of the ankle of the oral cavity or commissure of the oral cavity due to deficiency of the iron. Due to the deficiency of the iron, this epithelium becomes deepithelialized. Epithelium becomes deepithelialized, so epithelium is replaced by fibrous tissue, so there is an inflammation there. Okay, now again you will see the glossitis. Now in the tongue you have the certain papillae, and if there is the deepithelialization, epithelium has gone. So this tongue becomes very smooth one. When the tongue is a smooth one, there's no epithelium, the nerve endings becomes exposed. So there is the burning sensation, whatever the material patient eats, he feels there is burning over the tongue. A burning sensation is due to the loss of the epithelium over the tongue. And then there is due to the atrophy of the papillae, which are present over the tongue, it causes the smoothness, shiny of the tongue. So burning sensation of the tongue due to the deepithelialization and exposure of the nerve endings. So patient have the burning sensation and tongue becomes very smooth due to the loss of the PPD. Now this is the gallonechia. You see the gallonechia. Now what happens when there is the iron deficiency there? Hemoglobin is very low, so hemoglobin does not carry much amount of the oxygen from the lungs toward the periphery. And then there is a deficiency of the oxygen, which initially causes the blueness, and then there is the clubbing of the gallonechia, it becomes spoon shaped. The angle between the nail bed and nail becomes obliterated. That's why the term has been gallonechia. Now the post-required wave on endoscopy, if you go for the endoscopy, you will find there the wave formation. Now you see, normally the inlet of esophagus, it is epithelium. It is epithelium, and this epithelium is replaced by another epithelium. There is the sufficient iron load, vitamin B12 and vitamin B12. But if there is a deficiency of the iron, then you see it is replaced by the fibrous tissue. This is the wave formation. Whole is the wave formation. It is replaced. So here you will see the epithelium is there on one corner, on another corner it is replaced by the fibrous tissues. Due to the deficiency of the iron, this epithelium is replaced by the fibrous tissues. So term has been retained as the wave formation. Again, you will see here, this is the wave formation. Here the normal epithelium is there on one side, another there is wave formation is there. So this is the fibrous tissues, which has been which replaces the normal epithelium due to deficiency of the, and now this wave formation causes the dysphagia. This is the wave formation. Now the thyroid glands, you know, the thyroid tissues, they produces the T3, T4, and with the active participation of thyroid releasing hormones, they act over the thyroid follicles, and this needs the tyrosine and other enzymes. So when there's deficiency of the iron, their thyroid follicle becomes very much enlarged and fatty. So they look like as a nodule formation. Now here you will see the tongue is there, which becomes very smooth one, and term has been called as a glossitis. One of the septum will be the burning sensation. Patient will complain the burning sensation over the tongue, and if you see, ask the patient to protrude the tongue, then the tongue will be very much smooth one because of the loss of the epithelia and the papillae. So this is the sign where the tongue is very smooth one, and septum is the burning sensation in the oral cavity. Another is the repeated sometimes cough because of loss of epithelia from the pharynx. Then there's wave formation. You see, this is the, now this is the larynx, and this is the cricoid cartilage, this is the esophagus. Now this area is known as post-cricoid region of the esophagus because it lies just behind the cricoid cartilage of the larynx. So this is the inlet of the esophagus, this is your pharynx, this is the pharyngeal esophageal junction, and just here is the post-cricoid region of the esophagus. This is the narrowest point of the esophagus. So when there's iron deficiency, what happens? This epithelium is replaced by the fibrous tissues or connective tissues, and that is known as the wave formation. Wave formation means the formation of the connective tissues due to the atrophy of the epithelium. So this wave formation does not allow the food particle to enter from the pharynx into esophagus. That's why patient complains the dysphagia artificially in the swelling. Again, in this picture, very clear, this is the Krikwerth cartilage, just of the larynx, just behind the Krikwerth cartilage, you have the inlet of the esophagus. That's why the term has been retained as a post-Krikwerth region, and this is the wave formation. There are the fibrous tissues. So that causes the narrowing of the inlet of the esophagus, very, very narrow esophagus, which does not allow the solid food enter into the esophagus. Only the person can take the liquids. So the initially the patient complains of the difficulty in the swallowing for the solids because of the narrowing of the inlet of the esophagus. Now the differential diagnosis, I already told you in the previous lecture of the dysphagia, when there are the malignant tumors, you know, the esophagus, when there are structures there, esophageal rings are there, motility disorders of the esophagus, spasmotility disorders. So yeah, when there is diabetes mellitus is there, gastroesophageal reflex is there, and when there is the heterotrophic gastric mucosa is there, apophyllangeal bar is there, inflammatory conditions like the wave formation, skin disease. So these are the inflammatory conditions which can affect the esophagus. So that's why differential diagnosis means those diseases which causes the dysphagia. These are the certain diseases which causes the dysphagia. That's why they are coming to the ambit of the differential diagnosis. And differential diagnosis is very, very easily. You can go for the level of the iron, you can go for the iron level of the B12, B6, and for endoscopy. Endoscopy is a very, very a bigger tool where you can diagnose the pulmonary function syndrome very, very easily. Investigation complete blood test, CBC is done to see the where you will see the decreased value of the hemoglobin, hematocrit seen, and main corpus volumes. Peripheral blood means you will show the hypochromic microcytic anemia because of deficiency of the iron. Then again, you will go for the iron studies where you will see the decreased value of the serum iron and ferritin and increased total iron binding capacity. So this is the picture of the blood which will come when you go for the investigations. Now this is the peripheral blood smear is done where you will see this is the large RBCs there and where the iron deficiency has been seen. Now this is the how this spectrum of the iron deficiency. This is the iron storage normal. There's the when there the iron is depleted, yeah, iron is not there here. And this is the transport and functional iron. Iron deficiency, erythropoiesis. So this is iron deficiency anemia there, where transport of the iron also being affected. Histopathology. Now I already told you histopathology means when there is the replacement of the epithelium with the fibrous tissue. That's why term is retained as a wave formation. Sorry, there was problem in the internet. So again, we are repeating where we have just stopped. Now the best tool which we have to the investigation at the barium swallow or the barium esophagoscopy. Now the barium swallow, barium is a meal. It is iodine containing dye where we ask the patient to ingest it or swallow it. And during that swallowing process, we take the X-rays. Now that will show the movement of the esophagus and also the structure in the esophagus or the wave formation in the esophagus. Now I will show you certain pictures in the next where we have the barium swallow. So the barium swallow is the iodine-containing dye where we give the iodine-containing dye to the patient for the swallowing. So during that process, second is the video fluoroscopy, where you see the movements of the esophagus when patient swallows. I will show you this. Now this you see the barium swallow. Now the barium means the iodine containing dye where a patient swallowed that dye. Now, during that swallowing process, we take the X-rays. Now, this is the because the barium has the white in color. Iodine has the white in color, so this is the white in color because of the presence of the iodine or barium. And here you will see there the wave formation. Wave means the structure is there. You see the certain dilatation, then there is the narrowing, then there is dilation. So this is the wave formation which is seen over the barium swallow or X-ray. Now, if you go for this one, because post-cricoa region is at the level of the vertebrae, and you know the first, then second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth vertebrae. This is the area of the laryngeal inlet where you have the cricoid cartilage, and in the posterior side you have the esophagus. So this is the esophagus where there the wave formation there. Again, you will see this is the esophagus where dye is coming here, and then there is the wave formation there. Now the treatment. Now treatment, because this is the iron deficiency, you have to replace the iron. So first and foremost treatment is the iron replacement. Ferrous sulfate tablets are given. Iron replacement is mandatory to overcome the dysphagia. Ferrous sulfate, iron. And then they address the cause of the iron deficiency, like the celiac screws there, if there's bleeding or there's malignancy, you have to rule out the cause of the iron deficiency, either there's malignancy, bleeding, celiac screws are there. Then the treat the dysphagia and the wave. Suppose there's a wave formation, then you have to do the dilatation. Mechanical dilatation is done through the endoscope. Now in the endoscope, we use the bogies. Bogies are these, the flexible bogies, which we just introduced through the endoscope over the wave area, and then you break down this fibrous tissues. So these bogies are being used. Then again, you have another tool, that is the laser therapy. You can go for laser therapy and break down the wave formation or break down of the fibrous tissue through the laser. Then we have the needle knife electro incision, where you go through the endoscope and use the knife and just cut the wave. Now another is diet. Diet is very liquid one initially to make the movement of the esophagus go on. Now bogie dilatation, it can be, these are the very soft bogies you can do under local anesthesia. Very, very easy, and even you can go for the patient's health is very good, you can go for general anesthesia. That is the proper method. But if suppose the patient does not have the good health and it is not fit for the general anesthesia, then you can go through the local anesthesia. So these are the bogie dilatation of the esophagus. Long-term monitoring of this disease is very, very important. Because you don't know when the transformation of the wave into the squamous cell carcinoma. You have to keep the eye on the patient. You follow up very necessary. After every 3 months, you have to call the patient and see and do the endoscopy. So this is very, very necessary. And in the follow up, you go for the CPC to see the iron load after every 3 months. You call the patient after every 3 months and go for the CPC to see the iron load. Follow-up is very, very necessary after every 3 months, and it is recommended for up to 2 years. Prognosis of very excellent. It is very excellent if you diagnose the patient initially stage, very, very excellent prognosis. Put the patient over the iron therapy and you will see the excellent results. Complication, very, very disaster complication, it may turn into the carcinoma. Very, very disaster complication. Therefore, the pulmonary syndrome, you have the dysphagia, iron deficiency, callositis, and in the last, which is very, very lethal, is the squamous cell carcinoma. You see the Kalonekia, because of iron deficiency anemia, which does not carry out the proper oxygen, so there is a retention of the carbon dioxide, so there is a bluish discoloration of the nails due to retention of the carbon dioxide, bluish discoloration of the nails, and the loss of the clubbing between the nail and nail bed due to retention of the carbon dioxide, and the wave formation where the nail bed and nail head becomes, their angle becomes obliterated, and this is due to the loss of the oxygen and the retention of the carbon dioxide. Thank you very much. Any question if you want? Yes? Yes, question please. Now the next time we will discuss the laryngitis, very, very important, and there are certain questions which you will get from the laryngitis. And this pulmonary venous syndrome is very, very important again, because you can get the short AC over the pulmonary venous syndrome. So next time we will discuss the laryngitis, very, very important topic.